Hi guys, I'm Gesha. Welcome to the channel and welcome, as always, to our coffee times. Today I'm here to spill not the coffee, but the tea. I know, I'm very funny, I'm hilarious.
It's coffee time.
It is time to talk about the worst horror movies of 2020. Now, granted, this year has been crazy. I have tried to watch as many new releases as possible, considering the situation that we had in 2020. And here are the ones that I hated the most. Now, these are my personal opinions. Please do not feel offended if I trash one of your favorite movies of 2020. We all have different tastes. So before we jump into the list, if you love horror, if you love movies and TV shows, collectibles, please consider subscribing to the channel and also hit the notification bell so you don't miss any more coffee times. So these movies are a list of the ones that I disliked the most from the 2020 releases, and they are in no particular order. I already uploaded my best horror movies of 2020, so if you want to check that one out, it's already available as well on my channel. So now let's talk about the ones that were poop. First, let's talk about a movie that I kind of already knew it was poop, but I watched it for you guys. This is the sacrifices that I make, and that is Fantasy Island, an American supernatural horror film serving both as a horror reimagining and a prequel to ABC's 1977 television series of the same name. This movie has a simple premise. We follow a group of people that land on this island called Fantasy Island, and they go there in order to fulfill their most wanted fantasy. For some people, it's something they've always wanted to do, always wanted to have, and for other people, it's to go back to somewhere in the past where they wish they would have done something differently. So they want to relive that moment and, you know, make a better choice. So this movie had many problems, let's be honest. I thought it could not be worse than Truth or Dare, but I have been proven wrong. It was worse. Like, the acting was really not great, except one of the main actresses. The dialogues were so cheesy, and you know, if it's well done, I don't mind sometimes some cheesy dialogues, but it was just plain awful, and the twists and the turns were just predictable and boring, and it just ended up being a mess, to be honest. It was just so cliche. Like, it's probably one of the movies that has the most cliches that I have watched this year, and basically it was just nothing new, nothing like entertaining to it. It was just boring. Let's go now to a movie that I actually wanted to love, but I didn't, and that is The Turning, an American supernatural horror film. It is a modern adaptation of the 1898 ghost story The Turn of the Screw by Henry James. And this one is really interesting because we also got this year The Haunting of Bly Manor, which is basically also inspired on the works of Henry James, in one of those works that the, you know, the TV show is feeding from is The Turn of the Screw. And you can see how different you can tell a story. Now, granted, the TV show had more time to develop the characters and the story because they had more, you know, episodes, and they are nearly 1 hour each. However, The Turning, the movie, had many flaws, even though, you know, you can do a great adaptation of the story and make it into a movie. The problem was, for me, mostly the editing, the way the story was told and the way it was edited. It was so messy, it was just a mess. And I love Mackenzie Davies and Wolfhard Finnhard, the both actors I really enjoyed in other things. And the acting was not on point in this movie. I don't know, it was just boring, dull, predictable, and this is one of the biggest disappointments for me of 2020, because I was actually really excited about this one. The next one is a Netflix exclusive that tried to be something fresh and it completely failed, sadly, and that is The Binding, a 2020 Italian film about a woman that, while visiting her fiancé's mother in southern Italy, must fight off a mysterious and malevolent curse intent on claiming her young daughter. The thing is, the movie had a good start, you know, it was kind of promising. We see this family getting to the grandma's house in Italy, and I'm hoping to see these, you know, like atmospheric shots inside of the house. And apparently there is this evil spirit that wants to take possession of the daughter. You know, it's kind of something we've seen before, but they are trying something new in this movie, which I will give it to them. And I was kind of sad to see that it just didn't work, because most, you know, most of the problems for me were that they overused the jump scares and that the characters were not really explored, they were not fleshed out, and so you don't care for the characters at all. And that is a big issue in this movie, because we're supposed to follow a family that is fighting together to kind of, you know, free this daughter from this evil spirit, and you should be able to see this more sense of family coming together, even though they maybe don't see everything eye to eye, but in this kind of situations they are just there for each other, and that kind of just was not there. It has a couple of good creepy visuals, but it was just boring and in general, and I was kind of sad because, like I said at the beginning, I was really getting into the movie, and then it just went downhill. Another one that I was curious about, and I had my doubts because I enjoyed part one and I did not see how they were going to do a good part two, is Brams, The Boy 2, an American supernatural horror film starring Katie Holmes. The plot follows a young boy who, after moving into a mansion with his parents following a traumatizing incident, finds a lifelike doll he becomes attached to. I am one of those people that really, really enjoyed The Boy. I know some people didn't like it a lot at all, but I did enjoy it. And I had nothing against, you know, Katie Holmes playing on this movie. I was excited to see they were gonna do a part two. However, because of how part one ended, I had my doubts that this one was gonna work, and unfortunately this was a movie that was extremely predictable, extremely tropey, it had nothing really good, and some of the end scenes, the CGI, questionable, and I just was bored, and I didn't like all of these kind of trauma that they are adding to the story of Katie Holmes' character. I felt like it was not really needed to tell this story, because it's kind of like as if they had a couple of different ideas and then when they went to put the movie together, it didn't really work, but they just went with it. That's how I felt. And I don't know, I didn't enjoy it, not even half as much as I did the first one. Moving on to a completely different type of movie, we have You Should Have Left, an American psychological horror film written and directed by David Cope, based on the 2017 book of the same name. Strange events plague a couple and their young daughter when they rent a secluded countryside house that has a dark past. This movie is one that I was hoping to really enjoy because we are officially following the story of a writer that is having problems to, you know, do something new, like write something new, and he decides to go with his girlfriend and his daughter to the secluded house to try to, you know, start fresh, move on, look for inspiration. And the house really shocked me because it's one of those white walls, you know, a lot of windows made out of glass, like long glass windows, and it is completely different from your typical haunted houses. You know, it didn't have that horror vibe, which is something that I thought was really interesting, to see a horror movie set in a house that was not your typical, you know, mansion, decaying place, dark place. This was bright, and so I was hoping for something new and fresh, and no. The movie was a movie that had so much potential. It's kind of annoying because you can see the potential while you're watching the movie, but it was just not utilized properly. And the problem comes mostly from the characters and a couple of things from the plot that were not done in a really good way, in my opinion. You know, this couple moves there, there's a lot of things that are not explained, they are not explored, and it just gives you so many questions that are never answered, and it leaves you kind of a little bit disappointed in general. I don't want to tell you too much because I don't want to spoil the main, you know, plot of the movie. But yeah, like I said, just in general, I was really disappointed with it. And definitely the worst movie that I have watched that was released in 2020. I'm probably even worse than Fantasy Island, let's be honest about it. That is a Netflix release, sadly, that I was actually curious about, and that is The Devil's Mark, a Mexican possession horror story. The lives of a priest specializing in exorcisms and his adopted son change when they meet the Cuevas family and face the demon controlling their oldest daughter. This movie wanted to be many movies that were done before and ended up making such a freaking mess. This was one of the messiest, worst done movies I have seen, and I am sad about it because I do like some of the actors in this movie, and it was just horrible. It was extremely predictable, tropey, some of the effects were not really great, and they tried to copy from other horror movies, and you can totally see that. And it was just like, just don't watch this movie, okay? It is basically this girl that finds an ancient book in her mom's room, and of course she decides to read the Latin words of the book, and she releases this evil, you know, kind of like the Evil Dead kind of style. And then there's this priest that is trying to help the family with the daughter after being possessed by this evil that she released, and it's just bad. Let's just leave it at that. It's bad. Now let's talk about a movie that I, from the beginning, saw no reason for making, and, you know, I was like, I'm gonna give it a try, but it was definitely not needed like I expected, and that is The Grudge. An American supernatural horror film, at first announced as a reboot of the 2004 American remake and the original 2002 Japanese horror film. The film ended up being a side sequel that takes place before and during the events of the 2004 film and its two direct sequels. It is the fourth installment in the American The Grudge film series. The only connection to the original movies, the original story, are basically the first 2 minutes of the film, and after that, they just forget that they are making a movie based on a franchise. The film basically follows a detective that is investigating a death, and he realizes that a lot of deaths are connected to the same house. Now, the movie did have a couple of good things when it comes to like hidden ghosts and things like that, but like I said, it was really predictable, and the whole plot was extremely messy, and it ended up being like so disappointing. Like, from the visuals and the trailer, I kind of still had a little smidgen of hope, but no. The next one is one of the four that Amazon has released this year with their collaboration with Blumhouse, and that is Evil Eye. In this American horror film, a seemingly perfect romance turns into a nightmare when a woman becomes convinced that her daughter's new boyfriend has a dark connection to her own past. I mean, this movie is basically a long-ass movie about just that. A woman that it is an Indian woman living in the United States with very, archaic parents still living in India, and she gets a new boyfriend, and the mother is obsessed that that is some evil person from the past, and that is the whole movie. There is nothing else to it. There is nothing thrilling. There is nothing exciting. There is nothing scary. And this was just bad, like one of the worst for sure. Let's talk about number 9, because this is another one that made me really sad to put in this list, but I had to if I was to be honest with myself, and that is The New Mutants. An American superhero horror film based on the Marvel Comics team of the same name. 5 teenage mutants, Mirage, Wolfsbane, Cannonball, Sunspot, and Magic, undergo treatments at a secret institution that will cure them of their dangerous powers. Listen, I was able to go to the cinema to watch this movie, and I was really excited about that as well. The movie had many, many flaws, and I was really disappointed because having a superhero Marvel movie with horror was something that I really wanted to see. However, this was a half-baked movie that ended up not really being horror. Some of the CG works were questionable, and I believe that the reason why they postponed the movie was because they had to reshoot some things, but then they never really did, so we just basically got the same movie just a lot later, and I think that also affected a little bit how we saw the movie. And you guys know I love Anya Taylor-Joy, and I absolutely loved her in this movie, but I have to be honest, and you know, I have to recognize that this movie was not horror. It was messy, it was a little bit all over the place, and it did not deliver basically what we were expecting. Number 10, we have The Craft Legacy. I did say I was not gonna watch this movie, but then Amazon Prime was like, hey, here, watch it, and I was like, you know what? Maybe I'll watch it and then I can really voice my opinion on the movie. So here it is in my worst list of 2020. An American supernatural horror film in which an eclectic foursome of aspiring teenage witches get more than they bargained for as they lean into their newfound powers. It is a soft reboot slash sequel to the 1996 The Craft. Now the first 15 to 20 minutes of this movie, I was like, wait, maybe it's not that bad. Maybe I'm liking this kind of modern interpretation of the story. Okay, I'm open to it. But after that point, it just went downhill fast. So to my surprise, you know, I did enjoy, like I said, the first 15 to 20 minutes, and then it just went to hell. One of the main issues of this adaptation is that it basically does not use anything that made the first movie great, which I understand they didn't want to make the same movie exactly the same way because that would also not have really worked. But on trying to modernize the movie so much, I think they went way too much over the top and they tried to include anything that could, you know, kind of modernize the movie to the point where it felt like a social commentary for so many different things that we got lost in the story. And also the characters are not really fleshed out or explored except of the main character, and it was a pity because I didn't know these girls, like in the first original movie, you know who they are, you know why they're doing the things they do, and in this movie they're just so flat and uninteresting characters. The CGI, horrible, and I don't know, this movie had potential, actually. You know, I was shocked because, like I said at the beginning, I was enjoying it, but then it just ended up being just plain bad. Moving on with the last official movie on this list, before I also give an honorable mention to a movie that is going to be kind of like a controversial opinion, I guess, but you know, stay tuned for that. Before, I have to talk to you about another movie that I watched recently, trying to catch up with all the 2020 horror releases, and it was bad, guys, it was bad. And that is Dreamcatcher with a K. A horror thriller in which, in order to stop his bad dreams, a young boy steals a dream catcher from a mysterious neighbor, forcing his family to rescue him from a dangerous entity. The movie was extremely tropey, not just because of the story, the characters, the things that they did, but also when it comes to the jump scares, they were so unimaginative and so overused that I knew it was a jump scare like a minute before it happened. We have the typical car window where someone knocks, we have your typical you open the fridge door and when you close it someone is behind it, and I was like, oh boy, we're in for a ride, because that happens at the beginning of the movie. So we follow this man, his son, and the new girlfriend that are going to spend some time together at their house that they have by the lake to try to connect as a family. And the kid starts to behave really weirdly. He becomes kind of violent towards his stepmom. And you know, the movie, the problem that he has is that it's all over the place. This movie doesn't know what it wants to be, and therefore it failed extremely, super convenient. It has really clunky dialogues and it just was such a mess. And towards the end, there are some things that happen that are just like even laughable, to be honest. The kid does a voice at the end that I was like, facepalm. And yeah, don't bother watching this movie. I just wanted to give it a try because it was a new release, and you know, I do like to give them a try, but this one, as I expected, was just plain bad. Also, if you hate endings that are pointless, stupid, abrupt, and make no sense, this is the movie for you. And the last movie that I am gonna talk about, it's not one of the worst movies that I have seen in 2020, but it was such a huge disappointment for me that I wanted to mention it in this list. And I know it's gonna be controversial because I know there's a lot of people that absolutely love the film. And you know, I don't mean any disrespect to the movie, but I was extremely, extremely disappointed with Antebellum, an American thriller film in which a successful author, Veronica Hanley, is finishing a book tour before she returns home to her husband and daughter. A shocking turn of events is about to upend Victoria's existence, plunging her into a horrifying reality that forces her to confront her past, present, and future. Let's put it out there. For me, the script is the problem. I loved the visuals, they're stunning, the score, the acting, everything was great. But the script was very problematic for me. This is a movie that was confusing and not in the good way. And I feel like there is a problem when it comes to the way that the story is told and the way that it is being delivered to the viewer that just made this movie completely fail for me. But like I said, the movie is well shot, visually stunning, amazing colors, amazing acting. But if the plot, you know, the script is not holding it all together, it just falls. And that's what happened to this movie for me. I believe the movie is portraying really important topics that have to be discussed. I do not specifically agree with the way the story was told. I think some things were gratuitous or a little bit unnecessary for telling the story. I know a lot of people had problems with, you know, we bringing up again the story of slavery, but me not being a black person, I cannot really talk much about that because that is not a personal experience and I don't know how it feels and what it is like. I am judging this movie based on the fact that the way the story was told was really messy for me. I started watching the movie really excited. It had amazing visuals, it was really violent, and it was disturbing in the way that The Nightingale was, so that you have an idea of how it feels when you start watching this movie. And it is uncomfortable, and it's supposed to be, because the things that happens with slavery were horrendous, and it kind of is trying to tell the story and giving it like a modern twist, but for me that totally failed as well. The structure of this movie was really confusing because when you start watching the movie, it feels like you're watching a period piece, and then it moves into basically jumps to the modern world after you're already super invested into that period story, and it was kind of abrupt and it kind of cut the story for me in a way that it made it weird in a way, and you start to not really understand where we're going. You don't know if this is supposed to be time travel, if it's supposed to be something supernatural or fantastic that's happening. And for me, it affected the story, which was an important story to be told. So for me, the way they decided to structure the first, second, and third act was part of the problem, and the way that they told that story. I hope I'm making sense. If you watch the movie, maybe you know what I'm talking about. But I was just watching the movie and started to feel my excitement go down and down as the movie progressed. Another thing that I didn't really enjoy was the ending, which you can at some point see coming, and it felt just like these very visually pleasing ending, but that it was basically just a political statement. And this movie left a lot of plot holes, like a lot of the questions unanswered, things are not explained, and I ended up with the feeling of, what was the point here now? So I just kind of wish that they would have taken these important themes and they would have, you know, developed a script and a timeline in which the story would have worked. Sometimes less intricate is better when it comes to tell a story. If the story is the most important thing, if you want to have an impact with a story for the viewer, sometimes simple is better. And I think this is the problem of this movie. I know a lot of people are saying, oh, they tried to make something like Get Out and Us and it failed. And I can totally see where they're coming from, because like I said, they were trying to make twists and turns and intricate plot, and that is actually what killed the main idea for this movie. Alright you guys, so this was my list of worst 2020 horror releases from all the movies that I have been able to watch this year. I hope nobody was butthurt about any of the movies that I have chosen or my opinions on them. If you absolutely loved any of these movies, let me know down below why you loved it. You know, I'm always open for a discussion. And also let me know, what is the worst 2020 release that you have watched, horror or not? Let's talk about it in the comments and down below. Thanks so much for watching, you guys. I really appreciate your support. Please remember to give the video a big thumbs up for support, and I hope to see you all in the next coffee time. Bye.